Having febrile seizures is a scary experience for both the patient and their families. Families, I remember telling me that I felt my child is going to die. It was so scary for me. I'm sure if your child had febrile seizures, you have lots of questions in your mind, such as like, what is the cause, how we can treat it, how we can prevent it, does it cause brain damage, will it cause epilepsy, and so many other questions. So today, we will answer all of your questions and explain febrile seizures in details, and we will correct some of the misinformation and wrong practices that was practiced by doctors for a long time, and now it does change with new evidence and new studies. Hi, I'm Dr. Omar Danoun, an epilepsy specialized neurologist, and on this channel, you'll find all the information you need to navigate epilepsy with high quality and easy to understand information for you and your family. What is febrile seizures? Febrile seizure is a seizure that happens in little children, usually between the age of 6 months and 5 years, and it happens in the presence of fever and illness without evidence of brain infection. Febrile seizures happen in about 2 to 5% of the population, which is slightly higher than epilepsy, which happens 1 to 2% of the population. The majority of cases, about 90%, will happen before the age of 3 years old, and the majority will happen between the ages of 12 months and 18 months. What causes febrile seizures to happen? The cause of febrile seizures is a complex interaction between the patient's own susceptibility and genetic makeup and family history of febrile seizures or epilepsy and the preceding factor, which usually is a viral illness such as human herpes virus 6 and other viruses like the respiratory viruses and influenza, and even COVID-19 can cause febrile seizures, and also other infections that can cause febrile seizures. Vaccines also can induce febrile seizures in rare cases like the DTaP and MMR vaccines, which have reported cases of febrile seizures. And don't worry, we'll talk about vaccines in details later in the video. How do febrile seizures happen? This is very, very, very important piece of information to understand because that will impact how we deal with them and how we treat them. The body fights infection by the immune system inducing inflammatory markers. They are called cytokines, which are chemicals that facilitate the immune response, such as interleukin-1, interleukin-6, and tumor necrosis factor, TNF-alpha. Those chemicals and molecules, they will induce the immune response to fight the virus, and they can go to the brain, and they go interact with the brain cells, and specifically the NMDA receptor, which is the receptor where the excitation and seizure activity happens, and that will put these cells on and makes them excitable and irritable, and that will lead into seizure. So it is not the temperature itself causing the febrile seizures, it is the immune response and reaction to the viral illness that is the cause of the febrile seizure. These same cytokines have multiple other functions in the brain, and they will go to the area of the brain called hypothalamus, and this area will control the temperature in the body, and it will start producing chemicals like prostaglandins, and those chemicals will increase the temperature and will cause the fever. And fever will facilitate those effects on the NMDA receptors and the brain excitability and makes the seizures happen more and easier. So the fever is a catalyst for the seizures and not the cause of the seizure. Another thing that happens during the viral illness and the fever, the child will start breathing faster so that we'll get more oxygen, and in on the way we'll discharge all of the carbon dioxide, and that will make a state of alkalosis, which decreases the acidity of the blood and makes it more alkaline, and that will make the seizure happen even more. So remember, we treat epilepsy by making the blood and the brain acidic by using the ketogenic diet. And this is the complete opposite of that. You see, like, it's a complex interaction between all of those chemicals and cytokines and immune response, and the fever is only a facilitator and catalyst in this reaction. So febrile seizures can happen in any temperature. Sometimes very slight rise in the temperature can cause febrile seizures, like 38.5 or, you know, even 38, that can cause seizures, or like 100 degrees. And sometimes children can go up to 105 or like 39 or 40 degrees and don't have seizures. So it's not just the temperature itself, it's the illness and the immune response. What are the types of febrile seizures? We have two major types of febrile seizures depending on the way the seizures look, the duration of the seizure itself, and how many seizures that happens during the illness. One of them is good and it has no complication. One of them is bad and have some complication. First is the simple febrile seizures. Three characteristics. This seizure is generalized tonic-clonic seizures, happens with shaking all over the body, both sides the same. It will last for less than 15 minutes, so it's kind of shorter duration seizures, and it happens only one time during 24 hours or during a viral illness. This one is good, had no problems, and usually does not have any long-term complications. The second type is complex febrile seizures. This type, the seizures will be only one side, like will be focal seizures, will be one side shaking one arm, one leg, or one side of the body. The seizures will last longer than 15 minutes, and the seizures can happen more than one time in 24 hours, so they will be back-to-back seizures. This type is called complex febrile seizures. It can have more complications on the long term. Usually, after the seizures, even simple or complex, the child will go back to themselves after maybe 5 to 10 minutes of drowsiness and tiredness. If the child lasts longer than that, then we should be worried about other causes of the febrile seizure, such as brain infection or other causes. If you have any questions about febrile seizures or anything in epilepsy, please leave a comment down below and I will answer all the comments as I do to the best of my abilities. And I ask you just to follow on all the way to the end of the video because lots of information are coming your way. So before commenting, just make sure to watch all the videos and be welcome to leave a comment for that. Can febrile seizures cause brain damage? Luckily, short, simple febrile seizures do not cause any brain damage or any long-term consequences. However, in cases of complex febrile seizures, especially if the seizures last for longer than 30 minutes, which is now called febrile status epilepticus, this is a medical emergency, and if the seizures continue for longer time, more than 30 minutes, it can cause some brain damage if they are left untreated. So it is very important to seek medical attention if seizures are lasting longer. And that brain damage can lead to scarring in the brain and lifelong epilepsy. How to evaluate and test for febrile seizures? Any child with febrile seizures, when we evaluate the patient, very important to take a good history, which includes any like the duration of the seizure and what happened during the time of the seizure to kind of differentiate between simple and complex febrile illness. If there was a fever, vaccination, or any illness that is a trigger for those seizures, and if there is any family history of febrile seizures or epilepsy. The second thing is to perform a good physical exam. The pediatrician or the neurologist will check the child and do a physical exam thoroughly to evaluate for all the source of infection, what causes that, check the skin for any like viral rash or anything, and check the ears and the stomach and everything where the suspected infection. Most of the febrile seizures, especially the simple one, do not need any further testing. We will provide reassurance and just see the pediatrician and follow. However, if we have complex febrile seizures or we're suspecting secondary infection, then we need to do more testing and evaluation. First thing is to do blood work. So blood work like glucose, sodium, functions of the liver and kidney to kind of just evaluate the child in general and see if there is any secondary cause. And sometimes we take a blood culture if we're suspecting blood infection, especially in little children. Other labs to identify the source of infection, like doing urine analysis, doing swabs for viruses or strep throat, all of that can be done for specific reasons. If we suspect intracranial infection, like a brain infection, like meningitis or encephalitis, we might do a spinal tap, which is like putting a needle in the back of the baby and pulling out some fluid from around the brain so that we can test for any signs of infection, especially meningitis or encephalitis. And those can be serious and need to be intervened quickly and treated, and only in specific cases if we suspect that. Some imaging studies, like taking a chest x-ray for suspecting pneumonia, doing abdominal ultrasound suspecting that infection, or other x-rays and imaging for specific reasons for causes of fever or infection. Brain imaging, like brain MRI or CT scan, is not routinely indicated, and usually we do not do it unless we have focal finding on seizures and on physical exam, or we're suspecting some brain infection or something going on in the head. And the last test is EEG, a brainwave test. We cannot talk about epilepsy without talking about EEG, right? So EEG is a brainwave test, and we usually do not do EEG routinely for febrile seizures. However, we can do EEG to look for markers markers of epilepsy if we have complex febrile seizures or seizures start to happen without fever and we're suspecting a diagnosis of epilepsy, and the EEG will be supportive of that. Little boy Charlie, he is 20 months old. He had viral illness, runny nose with some viral rash, and he had a fever, and then he went into having a seizure. That lasted 2 minutes, stopped on its own. Family brought the child to the emergency. We checked that child, the temperature was 38.5 or like 101.5 Fahrenheit. The child was given antibiotics like Tylenol to drop the temperature. The child was happy and playing. Then this is a simple febrile seizures. No need to do anything else. We'll go home, follow up with the pediatrician and watch the child. That's it. And this is simple febrile seizures. Only in complex cases, we do other evaluations and follow up. Can febrile seizures come back and recur? The answer is yes. About a third of the cases, like 30% of febrile seizures, the child can have another episode of febrile seizures. And the risk increases more if the seizure starts before the age of one. That means the brain is kind of more susceptible, and the chances of the seizures coming back is about 50% if the seizure starts before the age of one. Other risk factors for recurrence of the febrile seizures is that if the child starts having febrile seizures even before the illness starts or even before the fever, or the fever was low grade, very, very low grade fever, like just 37.8 or 38, and that's like a child start having seizures, or if there is a family history of febrile seizures, that means there is some genetic susceptibility and the chances of seizures coming back is higher. The majority of time, the febrile seizures only happen one more time. Like if they will come back, they will come back only once and then the child will outgrow them. Rarely it can happen three or even four times, very, very rarely. So recurrent febrile seizures, lots of them might point towards a different condition or there is some underlying epilepsy. Remember, epilepsy is having seizures without fever and without any provoking factor. And this is a diagnosis of epilepsy that needs treatments completely different than febrile seizures. And we know that if patients with epilepsy, especially like the sensitive to fever, like Dravet syndrome, they will have fever inducing their epileptic seizures, and that is different than febrile seizures. Febrile seizures, normal kids, they have fever and they have seizures because of that. How can you help your child if they are having a febrile seizure? It's very important to time the event and how long it takes. I know it, like once the seizure happens, it kind of feels forever, like, you know, the time really stops and the perception of time really changes, and it feels like the seizure event happens like for minutes or hours. So look at the watch at the beginning of the seizure to time it, how long it lasts, because very, very important. As you saw in the definitions, the length of the seizure is very important. Second, you want to keep the child safe from hitting anything around them in the environment, clean everything sharp around them, and make sure they do not fall. Put them on the side so that if they throw up, things will come out of their mouth, not get aspirated, and make sure do not put anything in their mouth or try to put your fingers or anything in their mouth, because they are tensing up, and if you put anything, that can cause injuries to the child and even to your fingers. They will bite you, so they don't have control, and don't put anything in their mouth, remember, okay? And if there is the seizure lasts for longer than 5 minutes and it is long seizure, then you can administer rescue treatments that we will talk in a little bit. How can we treat febrile seizures? The treatment of febrile seizures is to treat the underlying infection, which is usually a self-limiting viral illness that happens in children. The seizure itself usually stops on its own within 1 to 2 minutes, and there is nothing you need to do about that. Unless it lasts for longer than 5 minutes, and that time we need to intervene and give medication to stop them. In the hospitals, we use medications to stop the seizures like lorazepam or Ativan, diazepam, and midazolam. Those medications we can administer to stop the seizures, and now we can have prescription of those medications so that you can take home and use for your own child and take the medications when you need them. And we can have a rectal diazepam like Diastat, or and we have other nasal midazolam and nasal diazepam. So those are very good solutions to keep handy, especially if the risk of seizures coming back is high. Very important to control the fever and the temperature. And remember that most of the time it's a self-limiting condition. Maybe like if there is a bacterial infection, we can give antibiotics. So treating the underlying condition, usually it's self-limiting and improves on its own, and we need to control the temperature. So if the temperature happens, if there is fever, we give antipyretic medication to drop the fever, such as acetaminophen or Tylenol and ibuprofen or Advil. Those medications are very effective in lowering the temperature, and we sometimes alternate between them, like give one another, usually 4 to 6 hours until controlling the temperature. If there is no temperature, no need to give medications to drop the temperature. And remember, we avoid aspirin in little children because that can cause toxicity to the liver and the brain and brain swelling, and it is called Reye's syndrome. Can febrile seizures induce long-term epilepsy? The answer is just slightly. The chances of epilepsy in the general population is 1-2%, and in patients who have febrile seizures, the chances increase 2-5%. So it is not a major increase in risk. However, the risk can be higher in cases of complex febrile seizures, or if there was febrile status epilepticus, or the child have focal physical exam with like weakness in one side or so, and there is a family history of epilepsy, or the child has developmental delay. That means there are some genetic tendencies for seizure. How to prevent febrile seizures from happening altogether? Question: can I give like non-stop Tylenol around the clock or acetaminophen to prevent fever if my child gets sick? So that's kind of question always have on everyone's minds. Like, you know, my child gets sick, I'm scared that the child will start having fevers and seizures. We'll just give them non-stop Tylenol and acetaminophen to stop the fever from happening. Another very, very important new advancement. Here's the thing. Doctors were used to give anti-seizure medications to febrile seizures to prevent them from happening again in life. So this was tested and studied in clinical trials, and the answer was that this should not happen or should not be given. Why? First of all, because the medications themselves have not been very successful in preventing future febrile seizures. The second thing, that those medications such as phenobarbital and valproic acid or Depakote, they have some side effects, especially on the little children's brain, and that can affect the development or even cause some neuronal cell death in cases of phenobarbital. So it should be avoided, and we do not give this now routinely. Only in the minority of cases, at the description or with the pediatric neurologist evaluation, if there were some like febrile status epilepticus and they're very aggressive and bad seizures, then we might consider treatment, but only in very specific cases. Can children with febrile seizures get vaccinated? I know vaccines is always like a very sensitive subject now, unfortunately. Here's the thing. Children with febrile seizures should be vaccinated, and this is based on CDC and on all the pediatric associations. They recommend vaccinating the children with normal childhood vaccinations, and the risk of febrile seizure with those vaccinations is very low. And remember, the vaccinations prevent infections, and those vaccines, especially the MMR and the DTaP, they have potential for prevention of serious conditions and serious disease. The infection with those bugs are much worse than the potential of febrile seizures. So definitely it is recommended to vaccinate your child with febrile seizures. However, we do some modifications. We give them DTaP, AP, like acellular pertussis, not the whole pertussis, which is now the common vaccine either way. It is very important to recognize this specific type of seizures and epilepsy in little children, because it is often misdiagnosed and missed by families and even doctors as other conditions. And it is very important to capture this type of epilepsy on time. Otherwise, it will have some dangerous and major complications on the child development. And to know all about this type of seizures and infantile spasm, it's called, you can see this video for all the details about this condition. And stay healthy and see you in the next one. Salam.